2500 BC, a man named Siddhartha Gautama was born into a life of utter privilege. His father was a wealthy ruler who wanted to shield Siddhartha from ever having to think about the hard parts of life. He fired any of his servants who were too sick, too ugly, or too old, and didn't allow anyone to speak to Siddhartha about life's miseries, like the fact that people die.
Then one day, when Siddhartha was 29, he took a famous chariot ride out into the world. And while he was out there, he saw a really old person, a really sick person, a really dead person, and finally, a really religious person.
As Joshua Mark writes for the World History Encyclopedia, through these signs, he realized that he too could become sick, would grow old, would die, and would lose everything he loved. He understood that the life he was living guaranteed he would suffer, and further, that all of life was essentially defined by suffering from want or loss.
This sent him on a quest to find the cure for suffering. In his quest, Siddhartha tries denying himself food and pleasure, then letting himself enjoy it, until finally he decides to sit under a tree and meditate until a real solution comes to him. Buddhists believe that under that tree, called the Bodhi tree, Siddhartha became a Buddha, which means awakened or enlightened one.
He then began to teach others his newfound way to escape from suffering in this life. His teachings would grow to become Buddhism, which is now the fourth largest religion in the world, influencing people from all walks of life, even people like the Beastie Boys.
In our last episode, we talked about Hinduism, and in many ways, Buddhism is a reaction to and a criticism of Hinduism. As Jennifer Hecht writes in her book, Doubt, the Buddha denied a central Hindu notion, that of the Atman. The religion of the Vedas held that human beings who had reached the stage of the Brahman could come to know their true self, their Atman, and thereby reach bliss and release. The Buddha said, look all you want, you are never going to find your Atman. Why? Because there is no Atman. There is no such thing as a self.
This might sound absurd at first, but the logic of this Buddhist idea kind of goes like this.
So, Dave, tell us about yourself. Who are you?
Well, I'm an executive assistant at a major pet products company.
Dave, I don't want you to tell us what you do. I want you to tell us who you are.
Oh, all right. I'm a pretty good guy. I like playing tennis on occasion.
Also, not your hobbies, Dave. Just simple. Tell us who you are.
Maybe you could give me an example of what a good answer would be. What did you say?
You want Lou to tell you who you are.
No, I'm a nice, easygoing man. I might be a little bit indecisive at times.
Dave, you're describing your personality. I want to know who you are.
In other words, who you are is not what you do, it's not your hobbies, and it's not your personality. But when all those kinds of things are gone, what's left? Turn to the person next to you and discuss this. How would you answer the question, who are you?
The Buddhist answer is essentially this: there is no you. The Buddha said that happiness was available to us if only we could simply set down our unfounded conviction that the self exists and must be protected. It does not exist, there is nothing to protect, and we are living in a very different world than we had ever dreamed.
This idea is one of what are called the three marks of existence in Buddhism. This one is called anatman, or non-self. The next one is called dukkha, or suffering. In the Sutta Nipata, the Buddha said, both formerly and now, it is only suffering that I describe and the cessation of suffering.
We'll talk more about that when we get to the Four Noble Truths. The third and final mark of existence is anicca, or impermanence, which is one of those things that leads to suffering. We cling to things that in the end don't actually last. In short, existence is characterized by suffering, by things not lasting, and by you not really existing.
And that's about as much of an answer into the nature of reality that Buddhism offers. Although there is a belief in karma and the cycle of death and rebirth, the Buddha often discouraged his followers from spending time on spiritual questions. As Thich Nhat Hanh puts it in his book Zen Keys, the Buddha always told his disciples not to waste their time and energy in metaphysical speculation. Whenever he was asked a metaphysical question, he remained silent. Instead, he directed his disciples toward practical efforts. Questioned one day about the problem of the infinity of the world, the Buddha said, "Whether the world is finite or infinite, limited or unlimited, the problem of your liberation remains the same."
In practice, though, many Buddhists today use the concept of karma to explain how the difficulties we experience in this life are likely a punishment for bad deeds committed in this life or past lives.
Some of the main practical efforts Buddha directed his followers toward had to do with the Four Noble Truths and the Eightfold Path. The Four Noble Truths are as follows. First, there's the truth of suffering, which we've already covered. Basically, life is full of suffering, and nothing satisfying really lasts.
The second noble truth is the truth of the cause of suffering, which is illustrated by the following passage from the Samyutta Nikaya, a Buddhist scripture. When touched with a feeling of pain, the ordinary, uninstructed person sorrows, grieves, and laments, beats his breast, becomes distraught. So he feels two pains, physical and mental, just as if they were to shoot a man with an arrow and right afterward were to shoot him with another one, so that he would feel the pains of two arrows.
In other words, although painful things always happen, the primary cause of suffering is actually our reaction to those things. By thinking we shouldn't be experiencing pain, or by becoming attached to things that aren't permanent, we make our suffering worse.
That leads to the third noble truth, which is the truth of the end of suffering. Specifically, this is the idea that we can stop having negative reactions to the pain we experience, and stop attaching ourselves to things, and eventually escape through nirvana, which we'll come back to.
The way this happens is through the fourth noble truth, which is the truth of the path that leads to the end of suffering. This noble truth refers to what has been called the Eightfold Path, or the Path of Liberation.
The eight parts are right view. Right view is accepting the Four Noble Truths, that suffering exists and that by following the Buddha's teachings, there is a way out of it. Right thought. The Buddha said that your worst enemy cannot harm you as much as your own thoughts. Don't let negative thoughts like greed, fear, and anxiety cloud your mind. Right speech. Focus on positive words and stay away from negative ones like gossip, hurtful words, and lies. Right action. The Buddha taught the philosophy of ahimsa, or non-violence. Instead of hurting others with your actions, you should try and have an endless love for all life. Right livelihood. Avoid jobs that involve death, weapons, slavery, the harm of animals, drugs, and any kind of exploitation. Right effort. Right effort builds on right thought. It means putting effort into welcoming and creating good thoughts and pushing out bad thoughts. Right mindfulness. Mindfulness is paying pure attention in every moment. Remaining in the present without judging or labeling your experiences and without letting distracting thoughts bring you out of the present. Right concentration. While mindfulness is like a giant net catching everything, right concentration is like a laser. Right concentration is what people would recognize as meditation. Using right concentration, you focus your mind on a single thing while meditating, whether that be your breath or thoughts. The point is to focus on that one thing without distraction, so you gain insight into reality.
That was a lot, so we want to give you a minute to process it. How would you summarize the Buddhist answer to the problem of suffering?
Thank you.
Here's one way to summarize the answer. It's all up to you. Some think that Buddhism is mostly about meditating and accepting everything, and there are secular versions that basically take mindfulness and leave the rest behind. But in addition to the Eightfold Path, most serious Buddhists also submit themselves to what are called the Five Precepts, which cover all aspects of life.
The first precept is to refrain from killing any living thing. This even includes things like mosquitoes while they're biting you.
One mosquito come. Then if my mood is something quite happy, then I usually give some blood, to the mosquito. Then it's the second time come, then more impatience. So sometimes I do like this, blow out. Then third come, then sometimes.
This precept is also why some Buddhists believe that to be Buddhist, you have to be vegetarian.
Precept two is refrain from taking what the owner does not give, which includes things like fraud, cheating, and forgery. Precept three is refrain from committing sexual misconduct, which includes but is not limited to adultery, rape, and incest.
Precept four is refrain from telling lies, which includes any form of deception and exaggeration, as well as angry words and even idle chatter. And precept five is refrain from taking any intoxicant or drug, even if you're of legal drinking age.
And the five precepts are just for common Buddhists. If someone wants to become a monk, there are 227 rules that have to be followed, and 331 for Buddhist nuns. These include many additional restrictions like no insulting, no tickling, no playing in the waters, no eating after noon, no traveling with a woman, and no stuffing your mouth full until it is rounded. The ultimate goal of these rules is to allow Buddhists to detach themselves from any kind of pleasure or desire, and thus any kind of suffering, and to enter into nirvana.
To meditate deeply, you find out that even ideas like being and non-being, birth and death, coming and going, are wrong ideas. If you can touch reality in depth, you realize that suchness means the ultimate reality is free from birth, from dying, from coming, from going, from being, from non-being. That is why nirvana is first of all the removal of notions of ideas that serve the base of misunderstanding and suffering.
The word nirvana literally means to be blown out or to be extinguished. In some Buddhist texts, nirvana is described as passing through the gate of emptiness, realizing there is no soul or self in anything, then passing through the gate of signlessness, realizing that nirvana cannot be perceived, and then finally passing through the gate of wishlessness, realizing that nirvana is the state of not even wishing for nirvana.
Although some Buddhists believe that living people can experience nirvana, others see nirvana as the logical conclusion of anatman, or the idea that we have no self. In that view, nirvana can only be experienced when we stop existing altogether.
People used to just tell me that when you're in a dark tunnel, there's always the end of the dark tunnel. But then I think what kind of helped me was I was sort of deceiving myself with this clear image of this bright light coming at the end of the tunnel. But it was more like finding the light, however small, whether it's a candlelight small or something small, in this darkness.
In other words, Buddhists don't expect anyone or anything to save or redeem us from the darkness and the suffering of this world. The only solution is to stop existing. But from a Christian point of view, this salvation is exactly what Jesus came to offer us. He is that light at the end of the tunnel. He pays the cost of all our bad karma. He breaks us out of our cycles of misery and defeat so we can step into life and hope. As Jesus himself says in John 10:10, the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full.
A full treatment of Buddhism would include a discussion of the differences between Theravada, Mahayana, and Vajrayana Buddhism. But unfortunately, we don't have space for that. As we leave, we just want to leave you with one final question. What would it mean to you to experience life to the full?